Amen. Woo. Man, God is good. Oh, you all are so weak today. What's going on? Y'all cold or something? God is good all the time. Let's praise the Lord together. Give him a big hand. Would you do that? Amen. Amen. Amen and amen. Well, glad that you're here. We get to worship Jesus today and get to just lift up his name. Great song, great words. You all have a seat for a minute, okay? I want to talk and be able to just share a little bit. The Lord is continuing to work around us and through us. And if you had not voted, the voting has closed, but we had some votes for the deacons, and we'll know what that is in just a few minutes. In a couple of weeks, we'll have some other votes coming up on a Sunday morning, and it'll be just for some other business we need to take care of, and that's okay. But let me mention this. It'll be in our happenings video. We have a family gathering coming up right after worship. Can y'all smell that? Okay, so y'all, let's get it out of your system. Go ahead and breathe it in, okay? Right? So that's right after worship. Everybody is welcome to come. It is food and fellowship. That's all we're doing. We don't have an agenda. We're just going to love one another and enjoy some time together. And even though I don't eat meat, I still like the smell of it, okay? So it's good stuff. We're going to go ahead and read out of Matthew chapter 20. So if you got your Bibles, you grab that, and we'll get to it in just a minute. I want to welcome you. If you are a guest, especially a first-time guest, thank you for coming. I'm glad that you are here, and if you don't know me, my name's Pastor Fran, and I'm glad to be here. And I know that if you have not been here before, I'd like to at least find out a little bit about you and welcome you here. I will not knock on your door and stalk you right away. I promise you, I won't ever stalk you. Okay, not right away. Just go ahead and fill out one of those connection cards that you have that'll be around you in the pews. And give that to me after the worship service. I'd just like to meet you and say hello to you. Matthew chapter 20, verse 20. Let's stand together in honor of God's word. Great passage here on servant leadership. I love this, the beginning of it. You know, you got James and John, okay? James and John, and they send their mommy, to come and speak to Jesus. Okay, so take a look at what it says. It says, then the mother of the sons of Zebedee, that's James and John, come to Jesus with her sons, bowing down and making a request of him. And he said to her, what do you wish? She said to him, command that in your kingdom these two sons of mine may sit one on your right and one on your left. So what are they doing? They're making a power move, aren't they? They're making a power move. And they send mommy to do that. And they're using a political system. But Jesus answered, you do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I'm about to drink? And they said, we are able. And Mark, he also says, the baptism by which I will be baptized. In other words, are you willing to suffer like I'm suffering? They don't realize that, but they agree to it. And he said to them, my cup you shall drink, but to sit on my right and on my left, that is not mine to give, but for those for whom it has been prepared by my Father. Now, what do you think the other guys think, huh? They're not too happy about that, right? So they're like, wow, there's a power move here. They know exactly what it is. In fact, it says here on verse 24, hearing this, the ten, became indignant. Well, that's a very kind way to say it, okay? We use other verbs, maybe, or descriptions, adverbs, whatever. But they became indignant with the two brothers. But Jesus called them to himself and said, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles, or the Romans, lord it over them, and their great men exercise authority over them. It is not this way among you. For whoever wishes to become great among you shall be your servant. Whoever wishes to be first among you shall be your slave. And just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Church, we are about serving. We're to be leaders who serve. We are to serve one another. No power plays, but serving. Today, we are going to be praising the one who served on the cross, Jesus Christ, who gave his life willingly for us. Praise God for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen? That we can worship him. Let's do that. Let me pray with you. Father, I thank you for the gospel. I thank you for the the chance for us to call on the name of Christ, that all who call on the name of Jesus will be saved. Thank you, Lord, for the chance for us to delight in your grace and your mercy. Thank you, Lord, for the chance for us to just lift up your name. Be with us as we do that. And Lord, may it be a time of worship to you, not thinking about ourselves, but thinking all about you. We ask this in Jesus' name, and everybody says, amen. Do me a favor, get out of your seats, say hello to someone. If you don't know their name, ask them their name. Don't offend yourself or them or whatever.
Strike you, you whitewashed walls. Do you sit to try according to the law, and in violation of the law order me to be struck? But the bystander said, do you revile God's high priest? And Paul said, I was not aware, brethren, that he was high priest. For it is written, you shall not speak evil of a ruler of your people. But perceiving that one group were Sadducees and the other Pharisees, Paul began crying out in the council, brethren, I am a Pharisee, a son of Pharisees. I am on trial for the hope and the resurrection of the dead. As he said this, there occurred a dissension between the Pharisees and Sadducees, and the assembly was divided. For the Sadducees say that there is no resurrection, nor an angel, nor a spirit, but the Pharisees acknowledge them all. And there occurred a great uproar, and some of the scribes of the Pharisee party stood up and began to argue heatedly, saying, we find nothing wrong with this man. Suppose a spirit or an angel has spoken to him. And as a great dissension was developing, the commander was afraid Paul would be torn to pieces by them, and ordered the troops to go back down and take them away from them by force. and bring him back into the barracks. But on that night, immediately following, the Lord stood at his side and said, take courage, for as you solemnly witnessed to my cause at Jerusalem, so you must witness at Rome also. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for these words that you've given us. Lord, let us take them to our hearts, Lord, and just remember them and meditate on them. Lord, help us to remember about your Son, Jesus, who gave his life for us. It was by his mercy that we are saved. And we thank you for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to sing a song today for our offertory called Your Mercy. We've been singing parts of this over the last 2 or 3 weeks. It's a great song. And really pay attention to the words. It talks about the mercy that God gives us. Let's sing together.
I walked away.
Gave me my
Father, we just thank you for this time. We can come into your house and just praise you and give you the glory. Lord, we just thank you how you work in our church, and we trust you, Lord, that you are the great God and you are in control. And we just look with great anticipation for what you have in the future and what you have in the future of Pastor Fran's life. Lord, we just thank you to take this offering, and we ask you to bless it and multiply it here in home and around the world, advance your kingdom. And help us be reminded, Lord, of Philippians 4:19, that my God will supply all your needs with his riches in Christ Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Wow. Y'all like that last song we sang? Oh, that great, great words. Amen. Amen. It's okay to clap. It's all right. Some of you are like, oh, should we clap? Oh, golf clap. Okay. Yeah, amen. Let's go in our Bibles. We're going to look at Acts chapter 23. I'm really covering a lot of territory in this. I actually wanted to cover a little bit out of chapter 21 and chapter 22. So, you know, I am just really just, wow, right? As we're going through this. But some of you, most of you know, some of you don't know this, and I couldn't even, you know, I felt like a blubbering idiot on Sunday night getting it out. I love you guys so much, but it was hard to say it, even after telling leadership ahead of time. But the Lord has, yes, called me to a new ministry to serve pastors in six different states and churches in six different states, Ohio and Indiana and Illinois and Michigan and Wisconsin and Minnesota. So this is the upper Midwest region of the Southern Baptist Convention. I'll be working for Lifeway Christian Resources, visiting pastors, ministering to them, helping them with training, helping them with teaching their churches about how to do Sunday school and children's ministry, and get this, multi-ethnic ministry. How cool is that, right? To be able to do that. But it was really a tough thing, because I knew that if I did that, that would mean that I would be leaving you all as your pastor. And I really agonized over that decision and grieved over that decision. But I also know that God has given on this hill a very strong church and very strong leaders and some awesome leaders. And I see now how God has orchestrated a lot of this, especially in the last few months. I did not know when I went into vacation. In fact, I told Harry and Jamie as I was going into vacation, because I talked to them a little bit about it, that they had approached me. I said, I don't think I'm going to take this. I did tell you that, didn't I? But I went in and I wanted to be faithful, and I prayed and I prayed and I prayed, and I'm here in the middle of the Gulf of Mexico, and I'm looking at this blue water, and I'm trying to talk myself out of this, and it was just such a strong calling from the Lord. So I hope you all will pray for me, and I hope that you all will welcome me as I come back and visit. It'd be great to have a pastor that was here to come back and visit, because I'll still be living in Green Hills. Obviously, I would want the new pastor to have a lot of freedom to lead, and so I couldn't be here a lot, but I wanted to be here to still see you all and love on you all and have a family reunion, right? Amen? Amen. So thank you. I hope that you all will pray for me, and I'll be praying for you, and I've already started praying for your pastor. So I'm just mentioning that to be encouraging, because I think that you as a church are a very strong church, one of the strongest churches in our association in Hamilton County. Did you know, believe it or not, that we actually led our association in baptisms in Hamilton County? Did you know that? That's a blessing. Amen. And I know that we've had a lot of changes, and I know that some people, you know, some of y'all need to take your changes pills or something, because some of you get allergic to changes or something. But changes are a part of life. And changes do happen in life. And if you don't think so, just look in a mirror and every so often, and you'll see those wrinkles get worse, you know, and those gray hairs come out of nowhere. And, you know, it's really weird. I tell the barber, you know, Willie, I've said this to Willie even, right? You know, Willie would cut my hair. And by the way, one of the best barbers we have is right here in our church, you know. And Willie was cutting my hair, and he goes, and he's got the razor, and he goes around my ears. Now, some of you guys know exactly what I'm talking about, right? And he's getting the hair out of my ears and all that. And I said, yeah, I don't know. It stops growing up here and it starts growing out here, right? The changes happen, church. It does happen. It doesn't always happen with pastors, but it also happens in things that we consider. And the changes that you all have considered have been lay-led. Name changes and structural changes and building changes. That is beyond any pastor. And in fact, the study teams will tell you, I had not been in any study team meetings. I didn't plan on that. I just thought, I felt led not to do it. Now I know why. Because they are led by the Spirit, and the lay people here lead it. We have a very strong church, and I hope if you're a visitor that you are encouraged that this church will continue to be a leader in Hamilton County and grow even more to be a multi-ethnic, multi-generational church in this area. And amen. Amen. But part of that is to live a missional life. And part of that is for you to be on mission. To be on mission or to live a missional life means you have to take seriously the great commission that Jesus has given you. In fact, the idea of being missional means that your entire life, listen, that your entire life is completely focused and surrounded by the gospel of Jesus Christ. That your life is not your own. That your life is not for your comfort or for your privilege, but it is the privilege of serving Christ in the gospel any way you can at all places. If you shop at the same store every week, did you know that that is your mission field? Your grocery store? Did you know that? It is. It is. How you treat that cashier is an indication of how you walk your walk. How you treat that waitress at that restaurant that you order at. You know, if you're a jerk, please don't tell them you're from First Baptist Church of Mount Healthy. All right? I mean, you know, how you treat that waitress or that waiter is an indication of how you live your life in Christ. How you treat your neighbors around you is an indication of the real deal. You are on mission. No matter where you are, no matter who you are, no matter where you shop, no matter where you work, and no matter how you live. So you need to be on mission, and that means you need to have a missional life. Now, I've got a short, several-part series on how to live a missional life that I felt that it was very appropriate to share my heart as we finish out the book of Acts, and we'll finish out with Acts 28 on my last Sunday here. But Paul certainly goes into a different kind of a mode here, that he is now kind of the mission is thrust on him. He's not going out on a mission trip. God has put it on him, and that he is in places that he not necessarily wants to be. In fact, in this particular case, he is actually standing before the council and before the high priest. The high priest is questioning him and asking him about his testimony. Now, Paul in chapter 21, chapter 22, already has given his testimony. He's already said all about who he was and how Christ had visited him on the road to Damascus. And he's already told them about how he was gloriously and radically saved in Jesus Christ. He's already told them about this transformation that's taken place in his heart. But now he is before the council, and he's standing before Ananias, and Ananias is starting to ask him questions. And what we can observe from this is that no matter where you are, no matter what you are doing, no matter who you are, no matter where you stand, whether you are at work or at home or at shopping or getting your hair cut, you're always going to be on mission. And the first thing you need to do, if you really are truly committed to the Christian life, the first thing you need to do is you need to learn to be a listener. We're not always good listeners, are we? If we get in an argument with someone, hey, brother, go ahead, sneak on up there and grab that thing. Go ahead. All right. Nobody pay attention to the man in the room right now, okay? I almost pointed Jamie towards the back when he brought it up. Or whoever it was, or Gerald, yeah. That'll change in a couple of weeks. We get to vote on some people, okay? We've got to cross our T's and dot our I's sometimes, I guess, you know? Sometimes we get a little ridiculous about that, but, you know, whatever. So here's Paul. Can you tell I'm a little impatient about some of that? So here we've got Paul, who is standing before the council, and we can learn from this a little bit about being a good listener. Now, like I was saying, we're not always good listeners. You ever gotten in an argument with somebody, and when you are arguing with that person, you just know that they're not listening to you? In fact, you know they're not listening to you because they are trying to think of their next argument to debate you. You ever have that happen? Maybe you have been that person. You know, you're getting in this strained, we'll call it strained fellowship, right? What do you call that, brother? Terry? That fellowship? Husbands and wives? Yeah. Intense fellowship. Thank you. With your wife or your husband. And you were arguing about something stupid, but as you're arguing about it, you are thinking about the next thing you're going to say. The inner lawyer in you comes out, right? You know, oh, I don't want to hear what she has to say. I'm ready to argue back. Ha ha, I got her, right? No, guys, you don't have her. My wife, she can argue circles around me, okay? But the truth is, we need to stop arguing so much and we need to listen a little bit. Amen? In fact, the Jewish rabbi said, you have two ears and one mouth and you are to use them in proportion. So we should be listening more than we're talking. Well, God is speaking to us and he's speaking to you individually and collectively as a church to be on mission with him. And if you're going to listen to God, you got to listen to Matthew chapter 28, okay? Where Jesus said what? Go therefore into where? All nations, making disciples of all men. And baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them all things I have commanded you. Jesus gave a commission. He gave you marching orders. He said, you are going to go out there and you're going to make disciples. How do you do that? Well, you know, obviously we're going to preach, we're going to teach, we're going to share, we're going to do life, we're going to help them to become disciples. We don't want to just tell them about Jesus and kind of like a drive-by shooting. You know, you tell them about Jesus and you never see him again. You want them to grow in the Word as well, right? You need to do both. But we've got to listen to what God is saying because God gives you opportunities all the time to talk to somebody about Jesus Christ. I gave you an example last week in a brief moment, but my wife and I took a bunch of Bibles with us to our cruise. And so we started handing out Bibles, and we had this relationship with the same servers, the head waiter and the assistant waiter, the same servers every evening. And we didn't want to go to the all-you-can-eat buffet for dinner, for obvious reasons, because I'm like a goldfish. I'm not going to stop eating. You all like that? When you go to all-you-can-eat buffet, you got to get that extra plate because you want to get your money's worth, right? Yeah, oh, why did I eat all that, right? Well, we went into the dinner place, and so we struck up a relationship with the waiter and the assistant waiter. And everybody on a cruise ship is from a different country. You know, they got people from the Philippines and from this one lady who's from Hungary and Indonesia and you name it, Brazil, Spain, Portugal, whatever. And so we had this relationship with this the waiter and the assistant waiter. And when we gave the assistant waiter the Bible, we gave it to the waiter and she said, oh, thank you for the New Testament. The assistant waiter cried. She was in tears. She was just awestruck that she got a Bible in English so that she can study English more. But also, she was faithful, she said, and she was a faithful Catholic lady who had left her country to go work on a cruise ship for several months to earn some extra money, a young girl. And she said, I did not bring my Bible. And she felt like God had sent us to her. That's on mission. That is helping her. And by the way, every Bible we gave them one of the tracts, brother. So we always had that opportunity. And then she asked me, are you a priest? And I said, well, if you want to call me a priest, I'm a pastor. I'm not a priest, you know. But it was a great opportunity to share. Church, what I'm saying is, you've got to listen for those opportunities and look for those opportunities so that God can put you on mission in your life. Okay, big introduction. He will press you. He presses us to His Word. God is never, He is never going to work in your life unless you are in His Word. Do not fall prey to this hocus pocus stuff that you can be spiritual but never be in the Word of God. Don't sit there and think that you can hear God speak if you don't know His Word. Because God is never going to speak to you. I can say that on solid ground. God is not going to speak to you unless you are in His Word. You say, well, Pastor, God's spoken to me before and I wasn't in His Word. Well, shame on you. He spoke to you in spite of you being in His Word. You need to be in His Word so you understand what God is saying. He presses you to His Word. And we see this here. Look at what Paul says to the council. Look at verse number 1. He said, brethren, I've lived my life with a perfectly good conscience before God up to this day. What's he saying? God has spoken to me. I know God's Word, and I have tried to live my life the best I could in good conscience before God up until this day. I had a chance yesterday to visit Miss Helen Dobkins, and she is in the hospital right now, and got a chance to spend time with her and pray with her and read some scripture to her, and what she kept saying to me at her age, in her early 90s, she said, I have lived my life the best I could, and nobody's perfect, but I have lived my life the best I could. I said, Miss Helen, you know nobody's perfect. But boy, oh boy, if you have served the Lord and you have served a life of faith, people can see that and they are changed by that. And it started with her being in His Word. I read Psalm 46 to her. And as I was reading that, you get to that passage where it says, be still and know that He is God. And she just repeated, she knew the passages, I was reading through it, and she knew the word so well. As I got to verse number 10, she said it with me. And it gave her great comfort. See, God gives you His Word, and He speaks to you through His Word. Now, look at the contrast here. Look at what a contrast we see here. You see Paul, who says, I've lived my life with a perfectly good conscience, and Ananias commanded these people, and they go, whack, right? They slap him upside the head. And these guys strike him on the mouth. And Paul said, God is going to strike. It wasn't very nice, but it's kind of true. God is going to strike you, you whitewashed wall, right? And he said to try me according to the law, in violation of the law, order me to be struck. And what he's saying here is he's calling Ananias on a carpet. Now, he didn't know he was a high priest, but he's calling him on a carpet. Here's Ananias. He's supposed to be an expert in the Word of God. He's supposed to know the Word of God. He's supposed to know all about the Word of God. But yet he's doing something in violation of the Word of God. He's striking him for no good reason. He's striking him on the mouth. You say, well, Ananias didn't do it. Well, he caused people to do that. And yes, he did do it. And the training that Ananias had for a priest was a high level of training. And for a high priest, an even higher level was to be expected, right? But let me just tell you something. Just because you know the Word of God doesn't mean that you know the Word of God. You know what I mean? Just because you know the Word of God doesn't mean you know the Word of God. There's plenty of people who know the Word of God, but don't know it here. There's plenty of people who know the Word of God here, but don't know it here. There's plenty of people who know the Word of God, but don't know the Word of God when it comes to their interactions with people inside and outside of the church. They're what people that Jesus refers to as wolves in sheep's clothing. You ever hear that term before? Yes, they're around. They claim they use this religiosity kind of a thing. They use this language of Zion, right? Don't you love that? They can know the bylaws and they can speak the language of Zion, but let me tell you something. When it comes to loving their neighbor, they know squat. I'm serious. And Ananias is a perfect example of this. He represents those kind of people that are in the church but not the church. They're religious but they have no relationship. We see that in all kinds of churches. Paul, on the other hand, has a very clear understanding of the Word. He knows the Word. He knows it here. He knows it here. He knows it here, and he knows it here. He's going out to preach the gospel always. Everywhere he's going, he's obedient to the Word. Through the last three chapters in the book of Acts, we see he is speaking the truth in love and sharing his testimony in Jesus Christ. And he was radically saved by the cross. I always say this, and I reminded somebody of this Wednesday night. And I said, you know, my dad, he was a deacon. I'm a son of a deacon, by the way. Now, I didn't grow up as a son of a deacon. My dad became a deacon when I was an adult. But he was a deacon, but he preached a couple of times. And I got to tell you, they were the worst sermons you'd ever hear. They were. He preached these sermons, and he got up there. And just like Sunday night, for me, he couldn't get the words out. Why? Because he would start breaking out, crying, bawling his eyes out. This big, strong man of God, breaking down because he was so grateful for what Jesus has done for him. So even though they were bad sermons, let me tell you something. They were memorable sermons for me. Because the Word of God had spoken to him, and he was saved, radically saved, and changed by the Word. And when God does that, he changes you from the inside out. He makes you do things that are according to his will. And let me say this, God will never cause you to do anything contrary to his Word. He will cause you to work for him, to serve him, to do things for him, but he's not going to cause you to gossip or slander or be nitpicky or be angry or be unregenerate in any way. He's going to cause you to serve him, just like Jesus said to his disciples. You know the Gentiles, how they lead and how they serve. They do this, right? Top down. It is not to be that way among you, for whoever wants to be first should be what? Last. For the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life a ransom for many. Church, if God is talking to you in the coming months, and he is speaking to you about this church, about the ministries, do not go contrary to his Word. I am telling you, if you bring somebody in here that is not going to preach the Word, I will come back and hunt you down. Because I've always told you, if I or anybody else ever preaches something that's not in his Word, you come at me, you come at them with torches and pitchforks, just like the villagers in a Frankenstein movie. Don't let people try to veer you off to make you afraid and do something that you wouldn't normally do because you're afraid of somebody. Don't listen to wolves. Don't listen to fear. Don't listen to new voices that all of a sudden they come up and they show up. Oh, I'm going to save this church. No, if you're a leader and you're serving in this church and you've been serving in this church, you have the confidence that God has got you exactly where he wants you to be. We've got four deacons that just got elected. Overwhelmingly, praise the Lord, our deacons have been elected. And we praise the Lord that we're going to have 9 or 10 deacons now. Amen. Never have we had 9 or 10 deacons. Why? So that they can help lead this church. Our staff is strong. Strong staff. Our team leaders are strong. We got a moderator of the church council. This church is going to be okay. Trust your leaders and love them and support them and encourage them. They don't need criticism, they need encouragements. And most of all, make sure that you bring somebody that will not just tickle your ears, but will bring you sound doctrine. Paul tells Timothy, he says, the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, and that people will, wanting to have their ears tickled, right? Ding-a-ding-a-ding-a-ding-a-ding, right? They will accumulate for themselves teachers of their own desires and turn away their ears from the truth and turn to myths. You don't want to look for a leader or a shepherd who's just a glorified chaplain or is going to entertain you or, you know, want you to, you know, I don't know what it is, but listen, make sure you got somebody who's a shepherd who leads from the Word first and then everything else comes later. We've got deacons who can minister to people. We've got staff who can minister to people. You want your pastor to be a man of the word. Don't fear what's doing right. He focuses you. He presses you to his word. Second, let God focus you on his gospel. He focuses us on his gospel. You know, as they slapped Paul and Paul apologized because he didn't realize it was the high priest, he then turns it to the real truth of the gospel. And in verse number 6, Paul says to the Sadducees and Pharisees, and he does this little move here, which is kind of a masterful move because he knew that they would debate about amongst themselves. But he still takes the gospel to him and he confronts him with the truth of the gospel. He said, I am the Pharisee, I am a son of Pharisees, and I am on trial for the hope and resurrection of the dead. And who is that? Jesus Christ. He doesn't say that, but that's exactly what it is. See, the Sadducees didn't believe in a resurrection of the dead. The Pharisees did. Sadducees didn't believe in angels either. Or the spirit. So they have this little argument going on, but it's funny that these religious people are arguing, and they're arguing, and they're arguing, but Paul is staying focused on the one thing, the only thing, the main thing, and what is that one thing? That is the gospel. Church, you need to focus on a gospel. If God is speaking to you, if God is helping you to learn and to be a listener, he's going to speak to you through his word, but he's also going to lead you and press you to doing the gospel work. Do not stop doing the gospel work. We've got a food pantry coming up on Saturday, and that is the gospel work. Do not take your foot off the gas pedal of doing the gospel work. Make sure that you are able to share the gospel with people that need to do the gospel work. Mission Ghana is still on, and they need to do the gospel work. We got 5 churches that we have planted in Ghana that we want to make sure that God has planted, not us, but God has planted. We want to make sure that they have support and the gospel continues on. Because God will do everything, listen to this and write it down, God will do everything to advance his gospel. He will use any way, any method, any possibility to advance his gospel. What worked in the 1960s and the 1970s and the 1950s and the 1850s is not going to necessarily work today. And what works today may not work tomorrow. You change the method, but you never, ever, 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 ever change the message. Amen? So you got to be willing to do things like name changes. I know there's a debate. You know what I heard Sunday night? See, I could say whatever I want now, can't I? What I heard Sunday night is I heard, hey, you know, we're okay. Most of you said this. We're okay with a name change. We're not okay with removing Baptists. Is that what I heard pretty much? I think I did. So, okay. You all think about that. Okay, we're not First Baptist. It sounds very elitist. It sounds very me-ish. We are the First Baptist, right? We're not a Mount Healthy anymore. So you find a different name that describes who you are, where you are, and describes your mission. Baptist or no Baptist, yeah, we're Baptists, okay? But what I heard mostly is people saying, we're Baptists and we need to make sure that people know that. And that's okay, church. You all need to talk about that some more, and that's okay. But the point is, you be willing to change the method. We're not changing the gospel. We're not changing the message. We're not saying that the gospel's not relevant. We're trying to get obstacles out of the way so more people can be reached by the gospel of Jesus Christ. In fact, we need to understand that we need to be all about the essentials of the gospel. So that the essentials mean that people have no doubt that in this church they know how to be saved. How do you get saved? I'll tell you how you get saved. God does it. Because God has given you the gift of eternal life by sending his son Jesus Christ. Why? Because you're a sinner. You see, God wants us with him. We're all sinners. I'm a sinner, you're a sinner, we're all sinners. Amen? Last I heard, we're all sinners, right? Yeah? 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 And we need a savior. Well, what did God do? He said, I want you in heaven, but you're a sinner. I can't let you into heaven because you're a sinner, but I want you in heaven. So what did he do? He sent his son Jesus Christ to die on a cross. And when Jesus died on a cross, he paid the penalty for your sins. And when he paid the penalty for your sins on the cross, he said, tetelestai, which means it is finished, which means paid in full. You're paid, your debt has been paid in full, but it's not automatic. You don't just say, hey, I'm there. Because any gift you get, Any gift you get, you got to receive. Amen? I'm going to give you my gift. Now I can take it back, okay? But, you know, I bought something from somebody, and it came in the mail. And the guy sent in the mail, he sent the thing that I bought to me, and he gave me a bunch of pens. Well, that was really cool. I like the pens because it's got a rubber tip on it. I can write on it on my phone and on my tablet. You know, and I was like, wow, that's really cool. I get to send his business card everywhere I go, right? It was nice to get the gift, but if I didn't receive the gift, it's not a gift. Advance his gospel. He focuses on, here's the third one if you want to listen to God. He presses us to his word and he focuses us to his gospel. Here's the third one. He speaks through his spirit. He speaks through his spirit. Now, let me just say, nothing comes unless it comes through his word. And remember what I said, you got to know his word. You got to be in his word. You got to come to Sunday school. But look at verse number 11. Look at verse number 11. Paul, of course, is a man of the Word of God, and he knows what the Word of God teaches, and he's obedient to the Word of God, and he's following the Word of God, and he's sharing the gospel everywhere he goes. But look at verse number 11 here. Go ahead and advance it to the next slide, brother, unless you've got a problem going up there. He speaks through his spirit. Okay, you want to write that down. Look at verse 11. It says, on the night immediately following, the Lord stood at his side and said, now, who stood at his side? Oh, come on now. You all, I didn't put you all to sleep now. Are you all hungry? You smelling that food and you're not responding here. Look, it's only 10:30 according to that clock. I got another hour or so, okay? All right? On a night immediately following, who stood at his side? Thank you. The Lord stood at his side. And he said, take courage. For as you have solemnly witnessed to my cause at Jerusalem, so you must witness at Rome also. In the stillness of the night, in the quietness of the night, the Lord specifically stood next to Paul and spoke to him. He said, as you have been faithful to the word, as you have been faithful to the gospel, as you have been my witness, then you will be my witness in the future. What you have done in the past, you continue to do and do in the future. You will be my witness in Rome. Here's what we learn. If you are faithful in a little, you will be faithful in much. Or a lot, if you want to say that. God takes your little faith and he turns it into a milestone. If you are faithful in knowing his word and teaching his word, God will continue to allow you more and more opportunities. If you're a Sunday school teacher and you're discouraged because maybe you only have a few teachers, let me tell you something. Or a few students, let me tell you something. You don't know the impact you have on your students. I have a pastor who took me under his wing back in 1992. 1992, that's 25 years ago. And this is really funny. I was the youngest guy in a church. Jamie, you kind of know that feeling, you know, being on staff and the youngest guy in the church just about. And I was the youngest guy in the church, and I was and I had just joined the church, and he said to me, he didn't say, what could you do, or what would you like to serve, or anything. He said, what area of ministry do you want to serve in? You see, hear the difference, the subtleties? It wasn't, you know, I know you just joined this church, you know, and I don't want to be that guy, but I was wondering if you'd like to serve this church. He didn't do that. He said, where or what would you like to do in this church? I was like, oh, Pastor Bill, I don't know what to say. And I thought, well, I always enjoyed working with youth and children. And he said, well, we'll set it up. So he set me up to start working with youth and children. And I worked with a couple of children and a couple of youth. And soon that youth group got bigger. And soon the children's ministry got bigger. And we realized the big difference is that the children's ministry was so much more fruitful because by the time they got to be 10 years old, if we didn't reach them by that time, it was really hard to reach them after that. So we began to play to that strength where God was working, and we joined him, and we started, this is before Blackaby came out, was experiencing God, but we started seeing God at work, and so I started focusing on children's ministry, and in 1994, he brought me on okay, as a staff person, part-time, which began the ministry that God has called me to. And so I began to work with him. Now, Pastor Bill never pastored a church that was bigger than 150 people. He was in Greenville, South Carolina, and he was bivocational for a long time. He was a plant manager at Crane Cams in Daytona Beach, and finally quit that to go full-time at the church that I was at, that I was ordained in. But he had never pastored a church bigger than 150 people. But let me tell you something. He has two men that has come out of his ministry, okay, that is serving full-time as pastors, and I'm one of them, and another one is Marcus Buckley. And we're serving the Lord still faithfully. Both of us got a doctorate, both of us serve. Let me tell you something. God used him to pour into me, which helped me to pour into you, which helped you to pour into other people. See, God guides you to a greater purpose in him. And he can do that, and it's behind you. And so Pastor Bill, I talked to him the other day and told him the news of what was going on, and he said, well, it sounds like a good opportunity for you to really reach more people. I said, it could impact thousands of people. And he said, I'm so proud of you. And he's my father in the Lord. He really is. And he calmly just said, just keep doing what you need to do and keep following the Lord and keep serving him. And church, let me just say, God is going to always speak to you to serve him in a greater way. It might be that individual person that you are ministering to one-on-one who then eventually becomes a servant of the Lord. I had one guy who was in a class, a Sunday school class that I taught, that was in a youth class. And he came for the first time, you know. And the day before, as I was planning out my Sunday school lesson, you're going to like this, you Sunday school teachers. I was planning out my Sunday school lesson. And I thought, you know, I'm doing Genesis. I'm doing the days of creation in Genesis, you know. I'm starting a new Genesis study for them. I said, I'm gonna have them do Play-Doh. So I pulled out a bunch of Play-Doh. My kids had plenty of Play-Doh. So I stole their Play-Doh for the day. And I took it to church, and they began to mess with the Play-Doh. Wouldn't that be kind of cool to play with Play-Doh? How many of y'all would love to play with Play-Doh for Sunday school lesson, right? So we're playing with Play-Doh, right? And this one guy who's there for the first time, he was like, cool. And he starts playing with Play-Doh, and he's there only because he likes a girl that's in the youth group, you know? And he comes back the next week, and 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 the next week. Eventually, he marries this girl. We got to be a part of that, okay? I got to see him baptized in the ocean, where the Lord sent a wave and baptized him. The pastor didn't have to do that. And he and I still talk. And he, in fact, said a few kind words on Facebook the other day to me. But he was touched by a lesson, and now he is able to minister to other people. Church, you will be able to minister to others if you are listening to him. That's my point here. Paul is sitting there in the still of the night, and God himself, the Lord himself, is saying to him, be courageous, take courage. As you have done for me, then you will do for me in the future. Church, as you have done for God in the past, and God has done through you in the past, he will do a greater thing in the future. That's how God works. That's what God does. And the first step to living a missional life is that you must listen to him. You must read his word. You must be in prayer. You must hear godly people speak, and you must watch for him at work and join him. How about it? Are you ready to see God work around you? You ready to see God work in your home? Aren't you tired of seeing drug addicts and crime and statistics? Aren't you tired of seeing misery all around you? Aren't you tired of fighting those fights that you have to constantly fight because of sin? Don't you hate sin? I don't know about you all, but I hate the effects of sin. It's disgusting, and it's horrible. And when I see the news, I don't even want to watch the news anymore. It's so awful, right? Isn't it time for us to make a difference in this world? We do that through the gospel. We do that by listening to God. Find out what God wants you to do and do it. Father, I pray and I ask that you show us and you teach us and you lead us and you guide us. That you help us, Lord, to know your will and to know your way.